Thanks for coming out, everybody. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. I am a student of things that you, many of you, most of you are experts on. I have a personal interest in this subject because I have been dealing with depression for about 10 years, and it was something that I kept to myself until a couple of years ago when I was on a panel at Ebert Fest, Roger Ebert's festival, at the University of Illinois. And it was a panel about mental illness and stigma. And I started talking about my depression, which is something I'd never done publicly before. And I've been somebody who's been very, shall we say, aggressive in saying that television shows should deal with this more frankly and should deal with it more openly. And I realized that I, in fact, was kind of keeping it under wraps because I had a touch of that sense of stigma myself. There's been a lot of writing at New York Magazine and Vulture about the representation of these issues recently. I'm going to quote from a little bit of them momentarily, but first I want to bring out our panel. First, I'd like you to welcome Dr. Gary Belkin, Executive Deputy Commissioner of the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. Next, we have comedian and writer Aparna Nancherla, who has a half-hour special coming out on Comedy Central. You saw a clip of that earlier. And then we have Mr. Warren Leight, who is the showrunner for Law & Order SVU, as well as In Treatment. He's also a Tony Award-winning playwright for Sideman. And finally, actor Gloria Reuben, who plays Dr. Krista Gordon on Mr. Robot, which was in the clip reel, and is also well known for her portrayal of Jeannie Boulay on ER and for portraying Elizabeth Keckley in Steven Spielberg's Lincoln. So I just got through co-authoring a book that looks back over the entire history of television, and some of the span that we saw represented in this clip reel is also covered in the book. You see the evolution of a lot of attitudes if you look back through TV history, and mental illness is certainly one of them. And I'm struck immediately by how distant a lot of those early portrayals are. Like, it's treated in a very clinical way, and things become much more sophisticated, I think, in the last 15 or 20 years, particularly with shows like The Sopranos and In Treatment. I wanted to start by maybe talking about representations of mental illness on TV and how media can help to lessen stigma. And I'll just throw this question out to the panel, and I should say, you know, although I may address some of you individually, if anybody wants to jump in, add to a point or anything, just go right ahead. What were some of your impressions of mental illness, of patients, therapists growing up? What did you think about them at the time? What do you think about them now? Maybe Gary, I don't know if you could talk about that a little bit.
Sure. First of all, thank you for all being here and for the Paley Center for hosting this and shining a light on this issue. This is really great. And I want to thank people on the panel and all the people out there for, even though I don't watch a lot of television, as you can see, there's a lot on television that is complicating and mixing up the representations we get of mental illness and how to treat it, which is really, really important. Stigma does matter. It affects people. It worsens people with mental illness, their condition. They experience this in society, and it worsens their ability to get better. It also makes it less likely for people to seek help. But it also, not only the individual context matters, but there's a public context that I want to underscore as well in terms of how society decides to invest in mental health. That comes from how we portray mental illness in these public ways. You know, I think there are some usual suspects that, in my experience watching television, that are, you know, we should try to avoid. You know, the violence mental illness connection. People with serious mental illness are much more likely to be victims of violence than perpetrators. The gravitational pull of serious mental illness. It's very exciting to see bipolar illness, schizophrenia, captured in much more complex, personal, experience sorts of ways, instead of caricatured ways, often about violence. But it's also important to see depression, anxiety, things that are actually much more common and also debilitating, understood as issues. So there are caricatures of illness. There are often caricatures of treatment that privilege the expert, aren't as curious about the individual's strategies for recovery and sort of how that really happens. But I think we're seeing a lot more interesting approaches that respect the diversity of all of those things. There is no single correct narrative of a mental illness. There are things to try to stay away from, like the violence connection, et cetera. But I think we have to understand that there is this diversity, and I think we're starting to see that now in television, that diversity of what these things mean in terms of the individual context. But there's also this larger social context, which I think is a bigger challenge to accuracy in media. And by the way, it's probably also a question, what is the responsibility of television as a media to be accurate? It's actually a hard thing to do, whether it's about high school or a workplace. You know, what is the test for the bar for accuracy? But if we really want to be accurate about the position of mental illness, mental health in our society, Orange is the New Black would have 60 to 70% of its cast with struggling with mental health issues. Any drama about high school would have, as we have in New York City, it evident that a third of high school students struggle with sadness and hopelessness, 8% report attempting suicide. So this to me is actually the really big challenge. It's as if we wanted to, if this was a panel about, are we reflecting diversity in our TV programs, the immigrant experience in our TV programs, we would say, okay, yes, individual context, are we getting that right? Are we really getting some accuracy about the individual experience of that? But we should also ask, in the totality of dramas about New York City, would one come away with the impression, oh, 40% of New York City are people who are born in a different country. 30% of economic activity in New York City comes from people who are born in a different country. So that would be that diversity conversation. I think in this conversation, we should also say, would we come away with dramas about anything, not just depictions of mental illness, but dramas about anything? Would we come away with understanding just how much mental illness factors in so many aspects of our life that are depicted?
Can I touch a little bit on this as someone who's been in front of the camera, not just on Mr. Robot playing a psychiatrist, but on ER when I played an HIV-positive character that was, as I think Mr. Robot is in terms of reflecting today's society, it was really a groundbreaking role and very accurate, and also very, really touched on issues like stigma and secrecy and isolation and how does someone, you know, what does HIV look like? What does mental health issues look like? Do you know what I mean? It kind of broke down those barriers. And one of the things that I think that's great about Mr. Robot, particularly, you know, for any age demographic, but particularly for high school students or college students, and I know that a lot of young people love the show because they really relate to Elliot, is this issue of, you know, how do we as a society disconnect from each other? Do you know, Elliot creates clearly has a different altered reality, and how do we do that as well? It really, I think, reflects what is going on. And New York City has its own challenges, as we all know. And I lived in Los Angeles for a while, where it can be incredibly isolating, because you're in your car all the time, and it's very kind of like this. But here, if you're on the subway platform, and you're around dozens or potentially hundreds of people, and everybody's doing this, right? So how much does that perpetuate isolation? Do you know, if you're already struggling with isolation and depression and feeling disconnected from yourself and from other people, how do we as a society, do you know, help each other and help ourselves by our own behavior? And one of the things that I think is brilliant about Elliot's, about Mr. Robot and the writing, is that it really touches on that, you know, the conversations that he has in his own head, the unresolved grief that he still carries with him about his fault. Like, there are so many issues at play. But it's that thing about the social isolation that I think everybody can relate to, even more now than ever before, because of these things.
I wanted to follow on that and bring it back around to the representation of mental illness and therapy and psychiatry. The opening clip reel that we saw is primarily a narrative of positive progress. It's incremental. You do see things becoming more sophisticated as time goes on in terms of the representation of treatment and also the different conditions that people are trying to deal with. However, two things jumped out at me. One was what I thought was, I would say, an omission of the bad stuff, which persists. And I remember as a kid growing up in the 70s, the first time I was aware of Vietnam veterans was from television cop shows, where Vietnam veterans were the people who eventually snapped and started shooting at police officers. That was all I saw of Vietnam veterans, and also vigilantes in the movies. And there were a lot of similar treatments on television of those types of conditions. When you watch television, when you watched television, what was the perception that you got of mental illness from watching TV, whatever your generation, whatever shows you grew up with, and what perceptions did you have of therapy, of psychiatry based on television and the movies?
Well, I think the therapist trope, growing up, I feel like whenever I saw people in therapy, it was like always upper class or upper middle class. Like, it definitely wasn't something everyone went to. It almost felt like an indulgence, like for the rich. And so it didn't feel like it was necessarily always tied to illness or recovery. Like, it was almost like, here's a place I just go to lie on a couch and muse about the world. But yeah, and I also feel like I didn't grow up seeing a lot of representations of mental illness on the TV screen. I feel like if it was, it was, like you were saying, Vietnam vets. Like, it was a very more extreme example where it's like, oh, this person, we can't predict what they're going to do. And then, you know, their erratic behavior is like a plot point, but they weren't humanized necessarily.
One of the things that struck me is it reminded me when I was a kid, mental illness was bad. And you would be isolated, and it was always depicted in I mean, that was the good stuff, and it was still pretty. He has dissociative disorder, and it was still very scary. And what it taught me as a kid, when I realized there was mental illness in my family, was to keep it very quiet, because the notion of those shows doing anything other than stigmatizing the mentally ill, I think is false. It was very clear, if something's going on in your house, that was the deal. So I think that's changing a bit. I think that's for the good. I think there's a number of reasons why so many shows are talking about it. But it used to be you're as sick as your secrets, but you keep your secrets.
Right.
And I think the tide may be turning. Although you see what happens when people do disclose. It's not all a great time for them.
We see a wide array now of different representations of therapists on TV. There are a lot of, and we were talking about this a little bit backstage, all the different flavors of the way that you can approach that relationship. Whereas it seemed to me that previously, when you saw a scene between a therapist and a patient on television, it was somebody lying on a couch or sitting in a chair, usually not talking. They had to have something dragged out of them, and they would say something that was quite poignant, and then the therapist would just stare at them blankly. And I didn't see a whole lot of talking going on the other side. And I saw that, and as a kid, I got a false impression of what therapy was.
I interviewed Newhart once, and I loved the Bob Newhart show. And I love Bob Newhart. But he said the one thing, he told his writers two things on that show. No hugs, I guess three things. No hugs, no children, and no one will ever get better in my practice. So the and I loved the show, but it was it depicted therapy as a place people could go where they could stay completely neurotic, and have no progress whatsoever. It didn't bother me at the time. I don't think it really bothers me now because he was just so good. But that was his understanding at that time of what he was going to do, portraying a therapist.
You know, one of the interesting things, again, about Mr. Robot is how Elliot breaks down that barrier between patient and psychiatrist. He literally does. He hacks into her life, he stalks her, and he confronts her boyfriend, whom she didn't know was married. I'm sorry, spoiler. I'm so sorry. I just assume everybody's watching the show. No, but...
Great. And he also uses... And he also uses that information to ambush you and mess with your character.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
And he tells her about it. Right.
Yeah.
So, and then she decides to continue the treatment. Right? I'm sorry. I've never seen that before on television.
Yeah.
And so that is, you know, I don't even know what that is. I don't want to think too much about that because I'm still kind of processing why she did. Anyway, it doesn't matter. But clearly, her priority is to do what she can to help this young man. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. There's some, even though it's an extreme breach of confidence and boundaries, etc. But there's something that she thinks that she could do to help him, you know, live in the real world, right? Yes, because otherwise the spin continues. And so I just think it's a really unique and brave way to, on a television show, to kind of shatter the whole perception of yes. what happens and what can happen and what sometimes does happen.
Rami Malek, when he got the Emmy,
yeah.
said he dedicated this to the Elliots of the world.
That's right.
And I asked Sam Esmail, I had an opportunity to interview him not too long ago for the Vulture TV podcast, and I asked him about that moment. I said, what do you think that meant? And I thought perhaps it meant, you know, the subcategory of the hacker or kind of the young alienated urban male. And he said, I think it's that, but more specifically, I think he's talking about people with anxiety disorder.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Exactly. And who doesn't have, you know what I'm saying? Who yeah. doesn't? Look at the world we live in. If you want to, you know, being a monk on a mountain, I think might be a little bit easier. But New right. York City, in this country, in this time, in the world, of course there's anxiety. And so how do we, you know, I believe that that's exactly what Rami was saying, that everybody, when he said everybody knows an Elliot, or everybody, there's a part of him in everyone. It's that
right.
anxiety, it's that isolation, it's that perpetuating an alternate reality.
Well, that's a positive response to art. That's a positive response to art. People who see themselves reflected in art who maybe never saw themselves reflected for, but I wonder, Warren, in your experience working on In Treatment, what kinds of reactions did you get from people who were in therapy, who had perhaps never seen therapy represented in that way before?
You know, people, it was a very intimate show. It's Patient and Gabriel Byrne, who should be everybody's therapist. you'll just keep showing up.
Not a lot of cancellation.
No, you know. They were basically two-handers. It was a one-act play every week, and they were very intimate, and the camera was very close, and it was half an hour of just talking. And so people, at first it seemed voyeuristic, and then they were just in the room with these people. And they felt very connected, and I got a lot of people telling me this is the weird thing when you write on that personal or an emotional level, people will come up and tell you, and will disclose to you things about their life because, they feel like they've been, there's something cathartic about watching the show and identifying with something one of those people is going through, and then it becomes difficult as the writer of a show like that or a play like Sideman, because people will come up and say, you know, my mom wasn't a drunk like your mom, but my mom was on pills, and they start telling you, and they're strangers, and you're a safe place for them to go to tell you things that they haven't told maybe their spouse. And you have to learn how to, then you go to SVU and you get a whole other level of people disclosing to you. And you have to learn how to absorb that.
Well, and then as a writer, don't you also have to grapple with, can I use this? What are the ethics of using this?
Oh, I have enough crazy stories in my head without getting them. it's never a problem.
But I think this position of the therapist is a real challenge. Getting back to your question about caricatures and TV is, you know, how do you portray the relationship between expertise and the person suffering? And how much do we privilege that? How much do we make it just simply about that? The sick person has to go to an expert. And I think in some of the clips you show and some of the shows emerging, it again makes that more complicated, that, you know, 1% of the person's life is in the therapist's office. It's what happens in that other 99% that actually is crucial to a lot of, you know, how life will turn out for them? And to understand, you know, mental illness and mental health struggles in that broader context, I think is a portrayal responsibility that is hard. The therapist, you know, therapy, I think, often is still portrayed in this kind of, you know, search for the cathartic moment.
I was going to mention Goodwill Hunting and Ordinary People.
Right, whereas it's more like, and not to, depending on how you feel about golf, whether this is a criticism or not, but therapy is more like you know, playing golf. You need some skills. And then you're figuring it out, and you're constantly returning to bad habits, but you are moving forward, and it's work. It's I mean, with Gloria on the panel, you know, it's harder to pitch a show. It's easier to pitch a show called ER than Chronic Care, or than you know, Life's Work, or you know. But the fixing illness in a person makes it harder then to portray what's really important, which is that person is somebody's child, somebody's coworker, somebody's, and it's that web of experience that is important both to understand what things are for them and what also needs to happen for them to master what's happening to them.
The word fixing is interesting. As somebody who wrote an entire book about Mad Men, which is really one of the most psychoanalytical dramas in the history of American TV, I was struck by the behavior of Don Draper towards Betty's therapist and towards the idea of therapy. And a lot of the, particularly the men on the show, but I think some of the women too, seem to see it as a sign of weakness. And there was also this obsession with fixing, with are you better now? Mm-hmm. And I think there might even be a scene where Don calls his wife's therapist and says, well, if she's not getting better, what am I paying you all this money for? Mm-hmm. Do you feel that we've gotten away from that to any significant degree on television? To furthering this misconception that it's about finding that cathartic moment, that rosebud, and then everything's fine.
I think so. I mean, even in this, I don't know how many therapists find their patients hacking, their files, but as a dramatic device, it just makes people think, there's lots of things going on here, right? Mm-hmm. Lots of needs, lots of things going on here. It's not just the expert dispensing something, and it's. But it gets back to my original point about I think one path to getting this better, in terms of what is portrayed out there, is to appreciate the commonness of this stuff. Mm. That the 1 in 5 New Yorkers have a diagnosable mental illness each year. The fact that of the top 5 causes of disability in New York City, 3 of them are mental illness groups. Just the ubiquitous. No one is not affected. Mental illness affects all the settings we go to. And how do we portray that? And I think if we start thinking of how we portray that, then we start getting at some of these other issues.
Aparna, you've been very open about your own depression and anxiety. Have you seen anyone on film or television that was particularly relatable?
I feel like growing up, not necessarily. Mm-hmm. I gravitated a lot towards characters who lived in their heads a lot. Like, I feel like Ally McBeal, as a sort of neurotic, I related to. And I think on Scrubs, they had a lot of things that he would play out in his head. And I feel like I related to that. But I feel like in terms of actually naming depression and anxiety, it sort of skirted around a little bit. Like, oh, she's just sad a lot. Or like he's, and I almost feel like the neurotic prototype was like almost like a lovable trait. Like it wasn't like, oh, this is debilitating to your life. It was like, oh, he's so funny. He like goes on these rants about, napkins or whatever it is. Like it just felt like it was used more as almost like just creating, it's like another character trait and not like something that's like, oh, this is something that might affect the quality of his life. Mm.
Gloria, beyond simply just interpreting the words on the page, what did you do in order to build this character in terms of a performance? How she behaves, yeah. How she speaks?
I can't. I mean, there's got to be a little mystery left somewhere.
Right, okay. But did you talk to experts? Did you?
Yes,
anything?
I did. I definitely did some research. But, and I don't mean to sound snippy with that comment.
I have a friend who's a cook, and he won't tell me what's in his ingredients. So that's cool.
But I think, I can say this, and I think it's kind of across the board for anything. But particularly for this role, is the fundamental humanity of it. Mm-hmm. It's obviously this is a profession and a practice and a situation and the need to be in up here, mm-hmm. in the head and dissecting and potentially rearranging or what have you. But underneath all of that, it's the fundamental humanity of Do you know? Mm-hmm. How is she going to connect with him?
Right.
I know that sounds, it's a very, I don't know how else to say it.
Yeah.
But that's how I approach it.
The idea of living in one's head, this is, you know, two panelists in a row have used a variation of that phrase.
Yeah.
That's interesting. The interiority of these characters. How do you, and I guess maybe Warren could jump in on this too, how do you draw that out in ways that are not just about people just delivering exposition?
I mean, it's tricky, and yeah, I'll go back for a second. When I did In Treatment, it was a low budget show. I said, I need something in the budget. I'd like to have psychiatrists and psychologists come talk to the very small writer's room before we start. And then I want a therapist reading every script and talk. I want to talk character lines, and they said, "Oh, we didn't have that the first year. Are you sure you need it?" And I said, "I could tell you didn't have it last year. You know, and you absolutely." And the first year was more based on the Israeli show, and I don't know if the Israeli show did or did not. But the second year was diverging for a variety of reasons. And I would never do a show like that without having a therapist on call, you know. And I went to him as if I were some kid like a year into med school, beginning to do therapy with people, and saying, "The guy came into the office today. This is what he's telling me. What do I?" Mm-hmm. And we started to talk about story that way. And I thought that it was. And then by the end, he said, "You're doing pretty well now. You're, you know." But you have to have people who do this for a living, you know, and the writers from everybody in that room, I don't think anyone have a problem. Everyone's been in therapy, right? Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean you know anything about the other side of therapy, which is the therapist's head.
Right.
In fact, the whole time you're in therapy, you're in your head. So it was really interesting to talk to psychologists and therapists about, well, you know, you kind of want to know. So do you know right away what's wrong with me? You know, how are you figuring out a strategy for getting me to real, you know, and just to try to get into the head. That was the hardest thing. Getting into the head of someone who lives in their head is pretty easy for writers because they live in their heads. But getting into the head of a therapist who is usually deliberately masking their reactions to you and hiding family pictures so you don't know much about their life and doing all of these things, that was the challenge. For me, on that.
But I would say, on the flip side, is to also, if you're going to portray people with schizophrenia, include people with schizophrenia in as experts. If you're going to, I mean, there's to get at the lived experience. I think is a new habit in art to really try to develop.
Particularly on television, I would say.
Yeah.
I want to see a show where you see the psychiatrist going to her own session.
They did that.
We did that. We did every fifth one was Gabriel going to Diane Wiest, his shrink.
Right.
And those were really tough to write. And actually, that was mostly Marcia Norman my year. She's not bad.
Oh, and I just have to say, as an in therapy geek, one of the things I loved about that show was that you saw, there was almost like you were seeing actors giving, you know, people as performers. That the first time you see them and come into the office, they are giving a performance as the person they would like to be perceived as being. And Gabriel Byrne is sitting there seeing through that and trying to basically get them to stop acting. And then when Gabriel Byrne goes to Diane Wiest, he's deprived of those tools because she's coming at him from a completely different angle. That's not the way he operates the other 4 days of the week.
He was a completely different character in the sessions with her, and he had to write his voice differently. And I think the more you don't, where the bad writing starts is when you're writing really crazy people. And then it's just, you know, schizophrenia on the stick, and that gets challenging. And again, it's
schizophrenia on the stick.
You know, at SVU we had Dr.
It's
Sasha.
Ben and Jerry's.
It's a flavor. You see it, you know, on network TV every hour. But so we would always have a psychiatrist who'd work with the criminally insane, and you always talk, and I would just you got to talk to this guy before you start writing that character, but you're right, better to, you know, and we did, we tended more to bring in victims and survivors than perpetrators. And I will say that there was some reluctance to bring rapists into the writer's room and that sort of thing. But we did try to, it's a challenge to get into that head and not purely demonize.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just going to mention one thing that across the board in terms of representations of mental illness, I feel like people of color are always absent. Like, it's always white people generally a lot, or it has been in the past. I feel like it's changing a little bit, but I still feel like if I was a young person today, I would still be like, oh, that is like a white person problem.
Or right, that's like that clip from Empire.
Right. Yeah, like, yeah. I reach a certain income.
See, now that was interesting because, or unless you're incarcerated, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. There's got to be another element
yes.
involved.
Yeah.
But that clip from Empire, I found really interesting because of how it almost was history repeating itself in terms right. of going back again to ER. You know, the story being told, a certain demographic in this country, the denial, the shame, the secrecy, the, oh, no, that can't be happening
yes.
in our community. Right?
Yes.
So it can also be sometimes, you know, specific communities that where stigma mm-hmm. Or silence, again, or secrecy or denial can exacerbate the issue. Do you know, mm-hmm. if you literally can't go talk to your parent about it because it's so taboo, then how are you going to talk, even have this the courage to talk to a professional? Do you
well,
know
yes.
what I mean?
Yes.
And it's really prevalent in certain I don't have the data. I'm just saying that from my experience of talking to certain
yes.
Communities, that there the
it's
stigma.
Interesting. There's a whole other layer to that as well, but specifically to that point is, you know, when we go around talking about Thrive NYC, which Commissioner Menon mentioned at the outset, every ethnic group, you know, stands up and says, you know, my community, this is really stigmatized, and you know, people from the Upper East Side to, you know, Central Brooklyn, that's what I, so there, but there are important different flavors of what that means. That's really important to understand. But I would take that a layer up, which is, and it gets back again to this idea, what I keep returning to, this idea of commonness. Can we portray the commonness of this? Is because it also asks us to look at other questions. If we're focusing on individually affected people, but what's the source of that? Now, different illnesses have different balances that we still don't quite understand of genetic, biological components and circumstantial components. But we do know that that discrimination experience drives that poor people are more likely to have this burden, that different, we mapped out geographies in New York City, more communities are affected than others. Mm-hmm. There are structural, discriminatory, economic, socioeconomic issues. Mm. So where does this stuff come from? Why are the people we're seeing on the screen here rather than other people we're seeing on the screen? And are we getting that right to query and expose the larger social forces that we all contribute to? That contribute to the mental health burden as well.
I wanted to briefly acknowledge one of my colleagues, Angelica Jade Bastien, who, if you don't already read her, you should read her. She's a terrific film and television critic, but she also writes a lot about mental illness and her own struggles with mental illness. Everything from classic Hollywood to modern television. And she wrote a wonderful article for Vulture, and she addressed some of these issues that we're talking about, and I want to quote a little bit of it here. This was about Orange is the New Black. She said, in a world where Orange is the New Black's crazy eyes is considered an important step forward, and Scandal's Olivia Pope manages to downplay her post-traumatic stress week after week, where is this mental health sea change for women of color? And she goes on to write, part of this is a byproduct of the dismal number of women of color behind the scenes in television, even as there is a noticeable uptick in diversity in front of the camera. But perhaps more importantly, the lack of well-rounded portrayals is a direct reflection of American culture itself. Typically, women of color on TV are relegated to helping others deal with these issues. Both Unreal and Mr. Robot feature women of color as therapists. Samira Wiley from Orange is the New Black will be portraying Gretchen's therapist on the upcoming season of You're the Worst. If seeing women of color struggle with mental illness on television wasn't such a rarity, having these women as therapists would not be so unnerving. But as it stands, television is sending the message that women of color are good for handling the emotional labor of primarily white characters, but don't deserve any care of their own.
Except for Jeannie Boulay on ER, but
that's true.
Current day, no, it's a good point.
Yeah, is there any way to address this issue besides, I mean, is it just as simple as opening the ranks of the writers' rooms?
Yeah,
I mean, that's really the only solution, right? Imagination only takes you so far, doesn't it?
No, I go over this all the time. If you're looking around, everyone looks like you. Everyone's gonna be hitting the same note.
Right.
You know, but you look at the writers' rooms. People hire people who they're comfortable with. People hire people that they know, because the biggest thing, one of the problems is when you hire somebody, if they don't work out, you have to pay them for the year, and you're on a limited budget. Mm-hmm. So you don't want to make a mistake, so you don't want to take a risk. So you hire the guy who somebody that you know told you was pretty good with story, and then it turns out he's horrible with story. but you have to overcompensate and really go out and diversify your rooms. And a lot of people are not there yet, and yes. I think that the showrunners are generally white males. There's a level of experience you have to have before you can run a show, and the guys who got in 30 years ago or 20 years ago have more of that experience than someone 3 years out of college. But they're hiring. It's an old boy network, and I think more pressure. You see a lot of pressure about it now, and there needs to be more. And it's incumbent upon showrunners to do two extra hires than they're thinking of to spill out. And it doesn't have to be, I got one of these, one of these, one of these. It can be imbalanced in any number of ways. It just shouldn't look like a softball team from 1956.
Right. that's an interesting point, because I think the flip side of that carries as well. Do you know, for whatever, you know, like, okay, in my lifetime, I remember seeing shows where there was much more integration.
Yeah.
Really, the Jeffersons, All in the Family. I know there's a 30 minute, but you know what I mean?
Hill Street Blues.
Where there was a combination, where there were two families, you know what I mean? There was kind of more, and now it's kind of getting a little bit black or white.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, again, that's a reflection of where we are in society, unfortunately, today.
My childhood was much more integrated than my adulthood.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. And that was reflected on television.
And it's a reflection of the mental health system. I mean, we have a segregated mental health system. We have hospitals where there are a lot of black patients and hospitals where there are all white patients. And who's in the room matters, not just in the writer's room, but also in the rooms that I travel in terms of what questions get asked. Mm. And how people explain what the issues are. Some of the real inventive things that we're trying to do with Thrive NYC is much more participatory models of how to act. There's a great project in South Central LA, for example, that brought community stakeholders together and just said, how as a community are we going to address depression? And equal partners, barbers, what skills do we need? And primary care practices, what skills do we need? I remember talking with one of the leaders of this. He started this project. He interviewed 300 people in the community, African American men in the community, about depression. And they said, depression, I don't know what that means. But I know what it means growing up with a narrative of the middle passage. That's my starting point. So you can't develop approaches that live up to the commonness of mental illness if you're not going to rethink who's at the table and how you think through and name these things.
You've returned many times to this idea of connecting the experts to the community, and we're talking about ways that this can feed back into the creation of art. I wanted to ask you, though, about one of the problems that I think a lot of people who make television run into by virtue of the fact that budgets are tight, schedule is tight, you have to produce a certain number of episodes a year. Is there not part of writers or some writers that is terrified of bringing experts in because it's going to mean that they have to rewrite their script?
Oh, I would say every time I go, did you get the notes from? So I hate notes. In fact, the episode of SVU that clip was shown from, I had a big fight with the person who started the script because it was about somebody in a mental institution who's been assaulted, and mm-hmm. can her story be believed? There was a little story within it that she was having, while institutionalized, consensual sex with somebody who worked in the institution. And I was new to SVU, but I was like, that's, there's no such thing as consensual sex between a patient and I, 3 a.m, I send an email out to the couple of the legal advisors, and they're like, no way, no way. And I told the writer, I said, no. And she got furious at me. And she said, well, I don't think that's true, and you're not gonna listen to those people, are you? And so there's a natural writer's defensiveness. Nobody, writers are generally anti-authoritarian. They don't like being told what to do. You get a bunch of them in a room. They don't, if you say, oh, it's a nice day, no, it's not. And so they don't want to hear it, and it mucks you. My rule on these shows is I want to know when we're breaking the rules. Mm. You're going to. I have to cure somebody in 7 half-hour sessions. Or get some progress, because I wanted to show progress in my ear. I'm trying to wrap up a murder. You're going to cheat. The DNA, but you need to always know when you are cheating and make the decision. You as the, to me, it's the showrunner's job. But you got to know when that would never. You always get an expert. There are guys who hire experts. And you say, is it possible that it could happen 1 in a million times? The guy goes, yeah, I guess. He goes, okay. So there are the lax experts. But you have, yeah. My rule is I want to know when we're making a mistake. And I want it to be our choice, not we screwed up. And that's the best. You cannot completely capture reality in 30 minutes that takes you 2 days to shoot. It's not gonna occur. But you at least need to know when you're cheating.
Well, Aparna, you're involved in podcasts and web series. Listening to some of the things we're talking about here about mainstream series production, mm-hmm. Do you feel that it's a little easier to address these issues when you're on a smaller scale, or is it the same set of character plausibility issues?
I think actually speaking to what Warren said, I think it is easier to address it like in web series or podcasts because you're allowed to sort of break the form a little bit more and extend one idea over many weeks, or a podcast, like people have 3-hour conversations and it's like you can listen to it if you want to, or you can just, listen to 5 minutes and be like, not for me. But I think it, podcasts especially, I feel like there's like a real boom right now because they're very intimate. They're like right in your ear. So I think people talking about shared experiences, like it really connects people, like when they hear other people openly talking about things that they might have experienced. And with web series, I feel like it's like a shorter form of content and it's like a nugget. So I feel like you can take bigger risks and there's like a smaller stakes, but it can, spread faster. Like the internet is good for that. If like something takes fire, like I think there was this one web person, Ali Brosh, who did like a web comic about depression, and it it circulated so widely, and I think it was just like an example of how if it strikes a nerve, it can really, yeah.
Yeah. So we're going to speaking of taking it in a different direction. Let's open the floor to questions. Anybody who has help. There we go. First one.
I write for television for Dr. Belkin. Have there been any television shows or films where you've gone, oh, come on, and thrown your remote at the screen?
I have to confess, I don't watch a lot of television. I think you can't get it right, but you could try to do no harm. And so I react to things that I think do harm. I think the violence connection often does real harm, and things that really isolate and really judge the person who is the mentally ill person, because it really discourages people out there from seeking help. I'm not one of those people, right? And so I think the things that are important is send different messages about what this is like. And I think some of the more recent shows you've seen are starting to do that. People get better when stigma, I think, fills a vacuum of the absence of good solutions, or for people to know that there are good solutions, that families can be skilled to be a primary way to get better, that the community that you're in, the things you do for yourself, self-care. That it's not about being a patient. It's not about having to rely on an expert. Although all of those are, although experts are important and often very brave. You know, with my golf analogy, which may not be a good analogy, you know, you play with other people, you get better by going out and doing it. But you know, there's that skill reservoir you have that gets replenished. But that's really just a small part of it. It's how do we build communities of acceptance and communities of support where people find their way? And that's really to depict that as common and important and achievable and worth society investing and happening for everyone. I'd like to see more of that.
Another one? Anybody? Hi, my name's James Freeman. I'm a psychiatrist. I had a comment. I had two comments. One, I haven't seen an ECT portrayal on television that has been realistic, and it's just worth highlighting as someone who I work as an inpatient psychiatrist with patients who have treatment-resistant depression. ECT is highly effective treatment, convulsive therapy for people who have resistant depression. And every patient I talk about it with thinks of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, which is obviously a movie, not a television show. That's like 40 plus years old, and it's still where people go. So it would be great if on television there was someone as a character that we admired who had a terrible depression, tried antidepressants, and ultimately had ECT and was effective, because it's really hard to get people to have this treatment, and it helps. Secondly, I'm a big fan of Law and Order SVU. I have a wife who's a psychologist who has a lot of trauma experience and watch it regularly. I think that there were two fascinating characters on that, and more recently in the last few seasons, there's been more about their personal life. So Elliot Stabler was this macho guy who everyone wanted to be, who had mental illness in his family and had issues around anger, wouldn't see the shrink. If he went to see the shrink, it was because he was forced to. Mm. And Olivia Benson, who is this strong woman, had PTSD and had this very intimate relationship with her therapist, which I think was really accurate and a wonderful portrayal of what therapy can do. Can we please have some macho guys that people want to be like, who struggle with mental illness and actually go into treatment, and even though they're successful on the outside, are actually struggling on the inside? Because the problem is, the message is still women talk and emote, and men suffer, you know, men are tough and suffer in silence, or not even that. I mean, there was the military did a big thing about real men suffer from depression. It's still like one of the big stigmas is men having any kind. I don't even use the word mental illness. Three quarters of my practice is men, not women. And I talk to them and I say, the first thing I say, the first visit is I say to them, it's not weak to come in and talk about your problems, okay? There are people who drink, who cheat on their wives, who, you know, who are road rage, et cetera, rather than doing that, you're coming in and you're saying, I need help. And that takes strength to do that. So if we could somehow get that message
See,
out
that is
on
a line
television.
I would steal. I mean, I would flat out steal that line. I got to SVU.
You're welcome to.
When I got to SVU, Elliot was going out the door. I would have loved to have written a character like that in therapy. I will tell you, it was very difficult. I write all the therapy scenes because everybody just goes, oh, you do that, you know. And it's Bill Irwin who's doing a beautiful job. It was very hard to get those into a show like that. And you have to fight very hard for the minutes that it takes away from the crime. And I'm relieved to hear that you feel there's a decent portrayal in there. But it was, that's a very tricky thing to put into a show that is so relentlessly in pursuit of bad guys, to stop and say, let's take a look at what's happened to her in this, right?
The function in our jobs that still struggle with mental illness, as many
people do, and I think that's the part that is also missed in television. People can, do anyone remember Prime Suspect, the English show with Helen Mirren? She was an alcoholic. She was terribly functioning in her personal life, but yet she functioned very well in her professional life.
Can you think of any characters who are open to therapy from the get-go? Any major characters, or are they always resistant? I'm trying to think of somebody who willingly goes.
Even Olivia was resistant at the beginning, right?
Yeah.
And on In Treatment, we opened pretty much everybody thinking this isn't going to work for them. I think there is an initial reluctance when you start therapy. I don't know, do people come in immediately and know they're in the right place, or is there some anxiety going in?
I think, as with everything we're talking about, there's huge variation, and it's hard to, and I think that the challenge is, can we show that variation as we depict these things? But no, it's anxiety provoking to reveal yourself to a stranger, to risk being judged, to not being sure if you're going to get better, as there is in walking into an oncologist's office or, all of this is existential to the person experiencing it. And there are many, many ways that that plays out.
I would say the actors are always nervous the first time they do those scenes. That's another interesting thing.
Why do you think that is?
It's different. If you've been playing a cop, I mean, Mariska knows how to arrest everybody in this room. Right? She had not been asked to do scenes like that. It was a different kind of work.
It's funny because on the flip side of that, well, first of all, I want to kind of echo what you said about the, you know, it's different for everybody. It's kind of anxiety. Can you open yourself up to someone new and what's going to happen? I don't know if I'll get it. It's like dating. Yeah. It's like a blind date. Anyway, but I love the scenes with Ronnie. It's so rare to, except for, you know, to have a scene, and he's extraordinary, so intelligent and sensitive and open in it anyway, so it makes it easy. But it's so rare to be able to do a scene with just one-on-one where you're actually not doing anything physical. Do you know? And it's a gem. It's like, please write more of that.
Once the actors start doing them, generally they like them.
Yes.
But there's an initial anxiety. They don't have a prop. They don't.
Because it's so intimate. Yeah. Right, exactly. There's nothing to do but just do this.
It's interesting that you say there's nothing physical in it, because one of the things I like about those scenes is I see you reading him.
Yeah.
And when he does something with his face or with his posture, your character picks up on it and redirects the questions or changes her tone or.
Right, but there's nothing physical to do, like tangible,
right.
Do you know?
Nobody's flipping a table over.
Right, yeah. So anyway.
Yes, we have one on the front there.
Hi, my name is Jeff Aaron. I'm from Fountain House, which is a center for people with schizophrenia, bipolar, and major depression. It's a community of acceptance and support, as Dr. Belkin was describing. One of the, first of all, thanks to the Paley Center and to all of you for having this great conversation. One of the things that I found interesting in the conversation is, and also in the clips, is that you are seeing people with mental illness, but in fact, most people with mental illness are not seen. Mm. Social isolation is the major symptom. And what we do need to create are communities of acceptance and support, places where people can come, find a purpose, work with one another, build their strengths. And in terms of the kinds of resources that are needed, everyone, the government, private support, individuals, the media, can help to create those kinds of places where people with serious mental illness, along with professionals, can create their lives. And I think that there should be, and can be, much more of that in this city and around the country.
And that gets back to this expert discussion, you know, where the expert fits in and why, and especially because it's anxiety provoking and layered with all sorts of symbolic meanings and so forth, to go to a therapist is to portray the many other ways in. We're investing in New York City in peers, in skilling up other people to be first points of contact that are more trusted, more comfortable. We've learned a lot about how many skills other people than specialists can have that really can make a difference, family members. And so, again, it's the commonness, not just of the issues, but it's also the less daunting positioning of what help is like, that actually that can be common as well.
You've talked a lot about this idea of normalizing it, of making it common. One of the things that continues to, I've gotten more sensitive about this in recent years, but it continues to anger me on TV, the more attention I pay to this, is these same cliches that we're talking about with the tough guy who comes in with his arms folded and apparently has good reason to be very defensive about therapy because the therapist says at the end of some painful thing he said, and how did that make you feel? And all those kinds of things. And you know, the leaning on violence and sudden revelations of mental illness in characters who show no signs of it as a way to solve plot problems. All of these things matter. And also I wonder about the language that we use every day and in the media. When you see this recipe for guacamole dip is insane. You know, the trivialization of these words, how do all of these things add up? And is there anything we can do to really push back against that? I mean, we're talking about it, that's a start, but what else? Is there anything else?
Well, I think you're hitting on the fact that this is a big issue. This is a paramount social issue. It's like engaging racism. We have to change a lot in terms of how we speak, what we name, who we include. It's a big issue. It's not just about getting therapy right. It's about actually portraying how mental illness, mental health works in our society and what gets in its way and what helps make it, what make it happen. And that means a decision that's a value that we have. What's been remarkable about the job I found myself in is that I'm now in a context in New York City where leadership values this. And you know, it's very interesting. Mental illness, you bring up the topic of mental illness, people get uncomfortable. You bring up the topic of mental health, you know, who's against that? And no, and it's something you would wish for a stranger. And so we you know, so what's blocking us from having a mentally healthy society, not exposing people to violence as children, not just, you know, all these structural issues and all these access issues and all these stigma issues affect all of us.
We have time for one more question. Yes.
Thank you very much for all of you for your illuminating observations about mental illness on TV. My name is Dewey Wygod. I'm working on a documentary about the treatment of the mentally ill. And it is about the brother of the director who became a paranoid schizophrenic, his experiences in and out of institutions, one of which was portrayed in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. It's called The That Way Madness Lies, out of a line from King Lear. And it will be screened Monday night in rough cut form at Yale University. Anyone who is interested, let me know and I can email you information. Thank you all.
Okay. Maybe one more. Yes.
Just looking at the clips, it feels like we finally got some protagonists who have this, who we're supposed to be rooting for, like Tony Soprano and Claire Danes on Homeland. And then the most recent clips that struck me were almost back at like Newhart, where like Crazy Eyes and Crazy Ex-Girlfriend and Maria Bamford's character, mental illness is kind of like a trait that you give a character. And it's kind of like, oh, it's interesting and it's cool, but like I don't know if it's like again the stasis of the sitcom where that's who the character is, and curing them will actually sort of ruin what that brings to the show. And I'm interested. Like it just struck me sitting here, like it wasn't something I came here thinking about, but we have acceptance on screen, but it's almost, is it a trivialization of it or? I don't know how to put it, but like compared to like taking a character like Mariska Hargitay, where she's been dealing with this stuff all along, been following this show for 20 years, wow, there's something going on behind the scenes. And then there's this other thing going on where people have mental illness and it's almost like the fuel that drives Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. Like if she didn't have that, the show wouldn't exist, right?
Yeah, but I would say just as, you know, an absolute beginner student of this subject, but also a guy who watches a lot of TV, I think that show takes it seriously. I think it does. I think it has, you know, wonderful, crazy musical numbers on Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, but her condition, I think they take it as seriously as they took all the issues of the characters on Mad Men. And I think Orange is the New Black in its own way does that too. And that show reminds me of MASH, but, you know, far more knowledgeable people than I are on this stage, so maybe they want to address that.
Well, I would just, if I'm repeating myself, I just push the same point. I think the next evolution of how we think about how mental illness is, and mental health are portrayed in TV is how accurate, what's our bar for accuracy? What are we striving for with accuracy here? And my complaint about Orange is the New Black, not having seen much of it, is prisons are mental hospitals. Are we portraying it that way? Instead of having a single, a character that is the stand-in for mental illness, do we want to portray the many places we portray on TV accurately to the degree that mental illness is very present and drives them?
Interesting. There are many characters who could be diagnosed that way, but not very many of them are identified as such. And I hadn't thought about that until you brought it up. Well, we have to wrap. It's been a wonderful discussion. Thank you to our panel, and thank you for coming out.